Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. As temperatures drop and the days grow short here in the Northern Hemisphere, and our thoughts turn to holiday plans, end of the year to-do lists, and the wanton materialism that encompasses our Yuletide festivities like a tacky tinseled Christmas wreath, the tech news rolls on. So thanks for stopping by for your weekly fix, because there were some media announcements that dropped, such as a new Steam Deck with an OLED screen, and NVIDIA confirmation that they do have something to show us at CES, which could be those super duper 40 series GPUs. And Rockstar, finally, and at long last, setting a date for the debut of Grand Theft Auto 6's trailer, which they probably figure will tide us all over for a couple years until the game actually launches on consoles, followed by a 3-year wait for the PC version and subsequent relaunches on the PS6, PS7, PS8, and Xbox Infinite and Infinite Series 0 through 10. I can't wait, and neither can the tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair IQ Link System Hub, a single small controller that manages all of your system cooling and RGB lighting. The IQ Link System Hub mounts magnetically to your case and can control up to 14 devices, 7 per port, with daisy chain support so you can simplify your cable management while still enabling glorious synchronized RGB. Corsair's IQ software can automatically configure IQ Link components while enabling precise fan speed control and real-time system monitoring. Click the sponsor link in the video's description for more on the Corsair IQ Link System Hub. Let's start with the new Steam Deck. It's not the Steam Deck 2. That's not coming till 2024 or 2025. It's the Steam Deck with an OLED screen, sort of a mid-gen refresh with some nice bonus upgrades. The new screen is very nice. The contrast and color depth of OLED tech combined with a 90Hz peak refresh rate has already impressed early reviewers. It's a 7.4-inch 1280x800 HDR capable touchscreen with 1000 nits peak brightness and less than 0.1 millisecond response time per valve. And since OLED panels are thinner than LCD, they've wedged that 7.4-inch screen into the same housing as the predecessor's 7-inch LCD panel, and they still had room behind it for a bigger 50-watt-hour battery versus 40 before, and the whole unit weighs 30 grams less. The APU that powers the unit is also 6-nanometer based now, which improves efficiency versus the original 7-nanometer APU, extending battery life further, and while the silicon is new, it should perform at least as well as the OG Steam Deck, with some titles getting a performance boost. Memory bandwidth is also increased from 5500 to 6400 megatransfers per second. There are quality of life improvements for modders too, with Torx screws that screw into metal, replacing Phillips head screws that went into plastic previously for the housing, and the Wi-Fi is upgraded to 6E, which theoretically can make game downloads transfer up to 3 times faster. There's a full list of updated specs and features on the Steam Deck website, or check the LTT video linked in the description if you haven't already for their full review. The biggest standout to me, though, was the price. It's the same, $550 and $650 for the mid and top tier versions, which also have storage upgrades, 512 gigabytes and 1 terabyte respectively. There's a limited edition one for $680 with a smoky translucent housing, and the 256 gigabyte LCD model is now the entry level option for $400. That's down from 530, although that still uses all the old Steam Deck hardware. It's good news just about all around for anyone who didn't purchase an LCD Steam Deck at full price within the past 1 to 3 months. The Steam Deck OLED will be available to order starting November 16th at 10 a.m. Pacific time, and units should start shipping out shortly thereafter. NVIDIA, meanwhile, went public Thursday with an update to their event calendar, right down here. A special address, not a keynote, mind you, those suck, is now penciled in for Monday, January 8th, the day before CES 2024 kicks off, confirming that they'll be in attendance and maybe, possibly, they'll be announcing the new RTX 40 series super GPUs that have been much rumored about in recent weeks. Further hints and leaks from regular sources like Copite 7 Kimi and Megasize GPU on Twitter seem to align with this theory, and we've now seen purported branding guidelines for retail box designs that include the super suffix, even attached to an RTX 4070 Ti, which seems like a desecration to me for some reason. Like, wouldn't the Ti and the super cancel each other out and you'd just be left with a regular RTX 4070? These attacks on our long-established sensibilities for how tech products should be named aside, the rumor mills seem to have settled on some of the details for the launch, which might include 3 GPUs, although this is not confirmed by NVIDIA in any way yet. Apparently none of them will use the big boy alloy AD102 GPU chip that the 4090 is based on. The 4080 Super and 4070 Ti Super will use variants of AD103, which is the chip currently used for the RTX 4080. These will both have 16 gig VRAM setups and have 10,240 and 8,448 CUDA cores respectively, as well as 320 watts and 285 watt TDPs. The 4070 non-TI Super, which is a designation I'm super happy I'll have to start making, will probably be AD104 based with 7,168 CUDA cores, 12 gigabytes of VRAM, and a 220 watt TDP. The success or failure of these GPUs, assuming they exist of course, will likely come down to pricing, as we already have a good idea of what NVIDIA's architecture is capable of, and these new GPUs should slot between the models that are already available. As usual, part of my brain is optimistic that NVIDIA will replot their pricing and bring some GPUs within the affordability range for many gamers. The RTX 4070 has been seen selling for as little as $520 recently after all, but the more pragmatic, bitter, and negative part of my brain is pretty confident that they won't do that, and come January you'll see another barrage of launch reviews that mostly focus on NVIDIA's greed. But let's worry about that next year, because still to come in 2023 is the hotly anticipated debut of GTA 6, the trailer. Rockstar posted an update Wednesday, reminding us all that they've been making games for 25 years now, or will have been as of next month, so what better time to show off the first GTA 6 trailer than early December, which means probably 1 month or less from now. The Game Awards will be held for the 10th time on December 7th, which could play host to the trailer, but Rockstar is just as likely to debut it independently. Speculation has been rampant about GTA 6, due in no small part to the long-lived shelf life of GTA 5, but Rockstar has previously confirmed that GTA 6 is in development back in 2022. Then there was the breach in September 2022 that revealed so much of Rockstar's development work behind the scenes, which has been forensically analyzed by most of the internet in the year or so since that info was leaked. But game development is a long and fickle process, and plans can change in the interim, so excitement has absolutely reached a fever pitch now that Rockstar has promised the first official trailer. So much so that one Redditor drank his own piss when the news was confirmed, as he had previously promised. So, much respect, GTA 6 piss drinker, for reminding us all to stay hydrated. And now we will just have to wait for the trailer. And then we can wait for the actual game to launch, which is still anticipated to be anywhere from April 2024 to March 2025, based on publisher Take-Two's financial projections. I just hope they aren't being too literal when they say, "We look forward to many more years of sharing these experiences with all of you." Many more years of sharing GTA 6 trailers without launching the actual game, Rockstar? I don't think we can drink that much piss. Speaking of drinking your own urine, some advice for when the next GTA 6 trailer goes up. Remember to first remove your tech briefs to prevent those unsightly dribbles. AMD has had enough of NVIDIA owning the AI arms race, and they will have something to say about it on December 6th. That's when their planned Advancing AI event will happen, which will likely showcase new entries in AMD's lineup of Instinct AI accelerators, such as the MI300X and MI300A. There's a small chance they'll show off Zen 5-based EPYC CPUs or discuss AI integration with upcoming consumer products like Radeon GPUs or Ryzen CPUs, but let's face it, AMD won't truly arrive on the AI world stage until they can get their accelerators banned in China. So let's go, Team Red. I end that bit with ambiguously. Speaking of AI GPUs that are banned in China, NVIDIA was told not to export most of the ones they make to the PRC and a handful of other countries within the past few weeks. But determined to abide by the letter of the law, if not the spirit, NVIDIA has already introduced new, even more cut-down AI accelerator GPUs that again slide in just beneath the limits imposed by those pesky export restrictions. The HGX H20 and the L20 and L2 PCIe should not exceed 4,800 trillion operations per second per their specs, and NVIDIA is apparently set to start taking orders for these new GPUs on November 16th, the same day the export restrictions fully take effect. So it's pretty evident that Jensen and company wanted zero downtime in their ability to continue shucking their AI silicon worldwide. Here's some niche news for photographers and videographers out there who hate waiting for high bitrate 4K videos to copy. There's a new SD Express standard, version 9.1, which mandates a PCI Express 4.0 by 1 connection for device connectivity. The previous standard uses PCI Express 3.0x1, and if you know your PCIe generations, you know that typically bandwidth doubles with each version, meaning throughput with version 9.1 is also theoretically doubled from just shy of 1 GB per second to just shy of 2 GB per second. That should save some time, but unfortunately, no word on when devices will come to market that conform to the new standard. Lastly, we have some smartphone news for anyone who has gotten into an iPhone versus Android spat via text message. I try to give Apple credit when they do good stuff, but likewise, I have no problem criticizing them, and their handling of text messaging and refusal to support RCS is absolutely intentional. It is more pronounced in the US, where iPhone adoption is higher, particularly among the younger generations, and the green versus blue bubble culture war has been leveraged by Apple to push sales to teens who don't want to get left out of group texts due to green bubble status. But Google thinks that the EU should step in to force Apple's hand, just as they did with the USB-C connector, per a letter that they sent to the European Commission that was co-signed by multiple European telecommunications companies. Time will tell if the EU decides to take this one on as well, but for the sake of families and clicky groups of teenagers who have been torn apart simply due to the color of their text bubbles, I hope they just get everyone to use RCS. I don't want to dig up my WhatsApp login. One final reminder before I go, mark your calendars for Saturday, December 9th, because that's when Kyle and I will be hosting our 2023 Extra Life charity livestream from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. or thereabouts with fabulous prizes, games, and well-mannered frivolity. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week. And if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested. And you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.